staff. This is a one-time change. Our normal meeting hour will be 7 o'clock from here on. Are we all on? Can you all hear us?
Yeah.
Are we connected? Okay. First item of business will be to go through some of our correspondence that we have received tonight, and I'll just note these for the record. They should be in front of you. January 10th letter to Mr. Gerald Daigle from Robert Hunter concerning data for January Planning Board meeting, and it concerns correspondence review of the Jordan Lawn Center and storm drainage at the proposed Maxwell Farm Market, transmittal of two items. I also have a letter dated January 10th to Michael McGovern from Ralph Norris of T.Y. Lynn, Hunter Ballou Associates, Elizabeth Farm Subdivision, Prout Manor. This is discussing the reduction in the amount of the bond or letter of credit, which I believe is the last item on our agenda for tonight. I also have a letter dated January 9th, and I'm having a little problem maybe reading the name,
Marie McClellan,
to the Town of Cape Elizabeth Planning Board concerning Gilbert Jordan's proposed building at the Agway Farm Market. Basically, it's a letter in support. And we have one drawing, which is an addition on the Jordan, Jordan Farm Market. It's like an additional drawing for our package that was not in our package.
That's right. It was requested at the sidewalk, as I understand.
Right. I think it identifies probably some additional screening and shrubbery that we didn't have before. In the order of events tonight, our agenda will start with minutes of the previous meeting, which you should have. Before we do that, I'm going to appoint Joel Russ as a voting member tonight. I don't think that requires a vote. So we do have a quorum for purposes of voting. Okay. Are there any corrections on the minutes of meeting dated December 20th, marked draft? Anybody have any questions on those, comments?
Mr. Chairman, I move they be accepted as printed.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? The minutes have been accepted. We have a bit of a difference of opinion here on the next item on our agenda. And for the clarification of everybody here, I'll try, maybe Steve can continue. We're operating under a set of changed rules. The town council has changed the bylaws, and the planning board has accepted the way we'll be operating. And it's my understanding that whereas we would normally have elected officers at our January meeting and ask them to take their places at the March meeting, we are currently, under our new rules, going to do the election in March and have the officers take their places at the same night as the election. So if that is correct, Steve, is that your understanding of it also?
Yes, it is.
I will, at this point, suspend that item from the agenda unless there are some objections from the planning board members present.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we table it and maybe handle it as a table.
Okay. Is there any second to that tabling motion?
Seconded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? We will table that item. I would like to make one comment, and it may be premature in one sense, but it's not in another. And as you probably all know, Alice Rand will not be running as chairman for the next year. We will be coming up with a new slate of officers for presentation at the March meeting and vote at that time. But I feel very strongly that the planning board should recognize Alice's many years of service to the planning board and to the town. And seeing as she's not here tonight, it gives me an opportunity and some leeway to say something on her behalf. It's not often that you witness somebody in a volunteer position, as Alice has been in all these years, putting in the time and effort that is required to really chair these sessions. I don't know whether the general public is aware of the many hours of preparation that goes into preparing the fairly weighty set of documents that go into a typical meeting session, and the work with staff to go through this and really understand the background of all these plans is quite extensive. And I think in our day and age, volunteer effort is something that some people say is on the wane, but it certainly is not in the town of Cape Elizabeth. We are very blessed in this town to have a number of people come forward to serve in these kinds of positions. And I guess what I'm proposing is that the right kind of letter, I actually can take a chance at it, if the board wants to give me the right to do that, to the town council, maybe through Michael McGovern, to provide some recognition for Alice, since she will not be running for re-election, would be a suggestion I'd like to make at this time if it has the approval of the remaining board members.
Excellent.
Okay, then I will proceed to try to draft something, too. I guess you're saying Mike might be the one? Is that Steve?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I'll check with
him. Okay. Then we will move on to item.
One other item in terms of housekeeping before we get on to the regular part of the agenda. I just want to mention it now, see if we can, if the board wants to deal with it. Given the fact that the next regularly scheduled meeting of the planning board coincides with school vacation, there was some discussion about perhaps changing that date, and there also needs to be a change in the February workshop. One, because Alice Rand won't be here, and secondly, because it seems like the topic for that we will be reviewing a hopefully final draft of the comprehensive plan. So those two items have to be set, and I think in terms of the planning board meeting, if we talked about it now, any items that then were referred off to that meeting, we would know up front when that might occur.
So basically what we're saying is no date during that week is acceptable, really, seeing that spring break. And we're talking about postponing to the 28th? Is that the plan?
The idea would be to postpone it to that week. Turns out that on the 28th, it's the regularly scheduled zoning board meeting. Monday is the council. So if we were going to push it off to that week, it would have to either be Wednesday, March 1st or Thursday, March 2nd.
What does that do to us on the March meeting?
Means the next Tuesday you'll have your workshop, and then 2 weeks later you'll
have that Tuesday
will you'll be have here. Three meetings in March.
Yeah. And one would be almost 5 days after the other, the way it looks like, if we do that March 2nd.
The workshop, most likely, the 7th will be canceled and probably pushed off to another time. But
I guess that brings up a question. Have you polled the board to find out that 21st is an impossible date for is it a concern from the board membership or from applicants?
From board, primarily board, one applicant. But it's, we can ask the group here. It was meant, I think, two or three.
Two or three board members?
Yeah.
That's getting on. Puts us into a...
But we can check, or it was mentioned.
I was not among those who would be away the time of all this, but now it appears that I will be.
So that makes it four. So that makes it certain that we'll have to change it. And that's the whole week once again. So we don't have any latitude within that week. So it looks like it's March 2nd. Is that the closest we can get?
First or second.
Mr. Chairman, we can't have a meeting concurrently with the zoning board if we went downstairs.
You don't have a secretary.
Don't have a secretary. And secondly, now we won't be in front of the cameras. That might not be all that bad, although we may... during that meeting, we may have one public hearing. I'm not sure.
So
it might make sense to have it
to have
able to be televised.
Right.
And taped.
I would prefer the first, only because it gets me out of a problem of coming late. But that's personal, because I'm teaching class now on Tuesdays and Thursdays.
March 1st.
Want to do it March 1st?
Fine.
What? There's no other calendar restriction on Wednesday night?
I checked.
Seems
the
like an odd night for a meeting in town.
I checked the calendar, and as of right now, it's free.
It's free. Let's grab it. So our next regularly scheduled board meeting will be on March 1st, and we will have a workshop. Now that's the next problem, I guess.
Yeah. When I was talking with Alice Rand before she left, we were talking about possibly having one on 2 weeks from then, either on the 14th or the 16th of February to review the comprehensive plan. First, we had talked about skipping the month of February, which would be very nice, and she didn't think there'd be any problem with that. But then I mentioned to her that the town council was going to be scheduling a workshop on March 6th to review the comprehensive plan, the most recent draft of the plan, and she had expressed, I think, the board's interest in having a first crack at the comprehensive plan. I mean, it doesn't have to be that way, and you can push it off till after that point, but her feeling was that if you did want to have some input early on, it would have to occur during February. And then we have, just to follow up on that, we talked about having the joint meeting with the South Portland Planning Board at the March workshop meeting, which would be...
So that won't be on the 16th. I had that tentatively noted on the 16th of February.
No, that would, it would... Now it would look like it would be on March March 7th.
Yes. On March 7th.
Yeah.
South Portland.
Will that be a dinner meeting?
That's the idea right now. Have to see in terms of... We'll have to talk further about location.
We'll actually be electing officers then on March 21st, right? Not in February.
Right.
So we're talking about a possible planning board workshop on the 14th. How does that fit the group here?
It's not, I know that I don't have to be at a workshop, right? Because I will be in away, so you'll have to have another secretary that night.
I don't think that's a problem from the standpoint of minutes, is it, Steve? Okay, so we now have a planning board workshop scheduled for the 14th of February. A planning board meeting, which would be the February planning board meeting, scheduled for March 1st. And all these meetings will be back at the 7 o'clock time, since I won't be involved as chair. And the 7th would be our joint workshop with South Portland, which will be the meeting. Does that take care of it? Next item on our agenda will be to get into Bluestone Corporation, which renewal of annual quarry permit, which is on for 7:45. Before I do that, I'd just like to welcome students from Cape Elizabeth High School, Mr. Ray's social studies class. I hope that you get something out of our meeting tonight, and certainly if you'd like to talk to some of the members before or after during breaks about what the process is all about, we'd be more than glad to answer any questions you may have on our process. Okay. Is there a representative from Leland Murray in the application of removal of earth materials for the Bluestone Corporation? Could you come forward, please, and identify yourself?
I'm Jim Murray, requesting the annual renewal permit for rock quarry on Sawyer Road. Under the same guidelines that we did in 87.
Okay. You should have in your packet a memo from Leland Murray on blasting at Bluestone, giving you the record of when that has occurred, the dates that it occurred. Should also be a plan of the quarry and its up-to-date state. Is that, this plan is up-to-date as far as your recollection?
That is correct.
Mr. Chairman, just to clarify, I might clarify if the board might be good for Mr. Murray to show the area of the blasting this year. That's one thing that wasn't on the plan. He'd indicated to Mr. Daigle where it was. It might be good just to have that on the record.
Yes, it would.
Be under number three, section number three.
Section number three.
Just below where I blasted in 84.
Mm-hmm. Do we have any record of any abutters objecting or any records of that?
We received the notebook. Also, the county received a notebook.
Any of the planning board members have questions of Mr. Murray on this program of blasting here? Okay.
Mr. Chairman, this is a matter of the board decided to approve it, and I wonder if you can discuss the policy.
Mr. Chairman, I would hope and second that, and they are apparently the same conditions as last year. So I hope we could.
Okay. There's been a request, I guess, that the order, which is one page in length, be entered into the record without reading. We should probably vote on it that way. So I have a motion that we suspend the reading of the motion. Does anybody second it? I guess it's been seconded. Is there any discussion on that issue? None? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Then we can now maybe just to help get this into the record to vote on it, maybe we could get somebody just to read the first paragraph and suspend all the following conditions.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we order that the application of Leland Murray for a special permit for removal of earth materials be granted by the Planning Board for a period of between January 17, 1989 and January 16, 1990, in accordance with Sections 19.38 of the Zoning Ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions which are enumerated, which we've suspended the reading of, which are the same conditions that we've had in the past few years.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion on this motion?
Mr. Chairman, only that when Mr. Murray approached the board, having bought it from a previous owner, he indicated that he would be spending a lot of time making sure that this is a clean operation and that it was conducted in accordance with the conditions that the town had placed on the previous owner and him. And I think we should recognize that Mr. Murray has done that on a continuous basis. And he should be congratulated. It's a very difficult, potentially very difficult land user, and he's operated in a very good manner.
Just to, Mr. Chairman, a further comment for those who think that we might be treating this application rather lightly because we didn't identify all the conditions that are set forth in this order are very stringent with respect to public safety, health, and welfare. And it is an application which we do take seriously, and the conditions that are imposed on Mr. Murray are important and good restrictions for them.
Thank you. I think those clarifications are very worthwhile because certainly this is an operation that improperly done would have caused an awful lot of grief and problems for the town, and Mr. Murray should be congratulated for the manner in which he has handled himself over these many years. Is there any further discussion?
He has been very conscientious about the conditions that have been imposed in the past, and I also commend him.
Any further discussion? We have a vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
We are early for our next item. Are the applicants for the Inn by the Sea site plan review application completeness here available for presentation?
We're waiting for one more member of our party.
He's here.
He is.
Would you like to proceed early?
Yes.
Fine. If you would just come forward and identify yourself.
I
Good evening. My name is David Jones. I'm attorney for the Great Cumberland Realty Trust, owner of the Inn by the Sea. We're here tonight with respect to the application for an amended site plan approval. You've all heard this speech at least once before, and so rather than reintroduce all of those subject matters, what I'd like to do is introduce the people who are here tonight. Steve Moore of Land Use Consultants, John Seavey of Seavey Mahar Consultants, and Ken Porter of Morgan Hill Construction. We have submitted a detailed package, I believe, addressing all of the criteria set forth in the zoning ordinance under the provisions on site plan review. We have been asked by the board to seek the input of the Inland Fish and Wildlife Department and the Department of Conservation. We're also expecting a letter from Bob Hunter, the town engineer, regarding the proposed storm drainage to the marsh. So there are at least two and perhaps three additional bits of correspondence that we are waiting. That is from Inland Fish and Wildlife, Department of Conservation, and the town engineer. And we will submit those as soon as we receive them. We think our application is complete in that we have addressed all of those criteria set forth in the ordinance, but the input from those additional sources was requested by the board, and we simply were not able to obtain their response in time for today's meeting. I'd like to introduce Steve Moore from Land Use Consultants, who will present the proposed site layout and discuss the location of the building, the parking, traffic, buffering, lighting, and other site considerations.
Thank you, David. As David has mentioned, my name is Stephen Moore. I'm with Land Use Consultants. We've been providing the surveying, civil engineering, and landscape architectural consulting services for Great Cumberland Realty Trust for the project. For the members of the board that were on the site walk, you're fairly familiar with the site itself. What I'd like to do this evening, rather than walk you through the entire site plan, is touch on the issues that have changed since the previous submission, discuss the buffering and the landscaping, the placement of some of the site improvements, and then just focus on the specific proposal at hand. The project as proposed will include the expansion beyond the existing parking lot. The existing parking lot is that area in white shown on my hand here. It shows up on the rendered plan underneath, being left here in white. The proposed parking is shown in green, the green trees and then the gray, here, with a new proposed six-unit building located just west of the existing units, which are set here. The proposal is to expand the existing parking lot out into the existing field, which lies easterly of the site, remove the existing Clark residence, and then develop a new six-unit structure down at the lower end of that field. That six-unit structure is slightly smaller than the other units on site due to the fact that they are 6 one-unit or one-bedroom units. So that unit shown there in gray is downsized from the existing structures which are on the site. The provisions for landscaping along the edge adjacent to the Rautenberg residence, which is shown here on the extreme right-hand side, have been revised from the previous submission. Based on some input from the abutters and some design input from our office, what we have arrived at for landscape buffering is a mixture of evergreens, which are shown in the dark shaded, and deciduous, which are shown in the light open circles, to get a broken effect but still maintain a continuous vegetative screen along that edge. But this will allow for some sight lines through from the adjacent site into the facility and will allow for air circulation in and out and around, while at the same time maintaining a low-level hedge and planting, which will help break up the headlights and screen this adjacent property from any headlight glare or wash as a result of cars moving within the parking lot. The islands within the parking lot have been designed to break up the mass and create two smaller pods of parking. There will be an existing green strip preserved within the parking lot to separate what is now existing double-loaded parking from the new parking lot to the east of that. And then a new pedestrian walkway has been incorporated into the site plan to connect the existing inn and the existing cottages with the new proposed six-unit building. So that walkway will continue out and around the parking lot and up and into this parking area so that visitors coming in utilizing this parking lot can get via pedestrian access and walk over to the inn itself. As a part of the submission, we're requesting that the existing restaurant be open to the public, and the parking calculations which have been done are based on the existing 48-seat restaurant being open to the public and providing additional parking for the 6 one-bedroom units and still allowing for parking to be provided for the employees on the site. As a part of the circulation, we are proposing to install or create an emergency access on the extreme edge of the property so that fire access can be, an emergency access can be secured in all seasons into the site, because the current proposal is to maintain this one existing access way and allow that to be our major circulator into the property itself. The other change that's proposed on this particular set of plans is that the dumpster be relocated. Right now, the dumpster is situated approximately here. As a part of the parking layout, this area is going to be paved and parking installed there. The previous submission had included the dumpster in this corner here to the extreme northeast. That has been relocated down adjacent to the tennis court on what I'll call the southwesterly corner of the property. It's shown here in that extreme corner of your plans on drawings L1 and L2. The intent of that is to move it as far away as possible from the abutting residential uses and then to screen it very heavily. The landscaping around it is intended to complement a screen fence with front screening so that that dumpster can be closed off visually from both Bowery Beach Road and from the inn itself. And based on review of that with the inn management, they have no problem with that in terms of location, so we feel that's a functionally successful and aesthetically appropriate response based on some of the neighbors' concerns and the Zoning Board of Appeals' concerns when they granted conditional approval of this particular use. I think in terms of some of the issues that were discussed at the previous meeting, if I could just touch on some of the utility issues that are on the site. As proposed, the parking lot will be paved, and included in the paving will be one catch basin. The intent of that is to gather the surface drainage into an enclosed storm system and then tie it into the existing storm drainage system which is on the site. As a part of this proposal, we are having catch basins with sumps, that is, catch basins with a small trap in it to catch the particulate matter which comes into the catch basin, so that sand and debris and trash which might wash into the system are caught in the catch basins themselves and not washed out the outfall pipe. In addition, on the inlet within the catch basin, we're proposing to install a Casco trap. Those are shown on your final drawing, L4, I believe, shown as a hood or cowling which is located over the pipe itself. The intent of that is to preclude oil and other waterborne debris and organic matter from floating up and out of the pipes and then finding its way down into the marsh. And because the existing outfall exits in here and a pipe comes up into the site, there's no need to disturb the existing outfall pipe or drainage area, the connection and reconnection for this new storm system we made up interior to the site, so we will not be disturbing this downslope area, which was done back in 1986 as a part of phase one. The underground electric will be rerouted on the site. Right now, that existing electric comes into the site by underground from a service drop just off the end of this pole here. That will be rerouted slightly and kept in basically the same location, with new underground electrical services being run into the six-unit cottage. In addition, the water service will be run in underground, extending from units 13 to 18 up into the new six-unit building. So that, again, we won't be required to tear up the existing parking. That will be underground routing from existing infrastructure on the site. As a part of this proposal, The subsurface disposal system will be expanded, specifically based on some negotiations with Health and Human Services. The design is based on taking the existing restaurant use and running the restaurant into a new subsurface disposal system located under the parking lot in this corner of the parcel up towards Bowery Beach Road in what I'll call the northwest corner. That new subsurface disposal system is detailed on one of your drawings, and it's designed very similar to the existing subsurface system, which sits down under the existing parking, tennis court, and lawn area down to this southwesterly portion of the site. That subsurface disposal system is a pressure dose system. If you recall, there was some discussion on that the last time this went through the approval process. And unlike a normal gravity system, this particular system is run via pumps. And the restaurant effluent, after coming out of the kitchen, will run into a separate pump station after passing through several tanks, two tanks to be specific, and then be pumped under pressure up into the field, and the effluent distributed within the fields in a subsurface system via PVC piping in the chamber system. The new six-unit building will be fed via gravity back into the existing system, which is located here, so that what we're trading for flows out of the public or out of the now private restaurant will be pulled into a new system and the six-unit building put into the existing system. That design is up before Health and Human Services now for review because it is an engineered system, and there's been correspondence back and forth regarding that, and I'm available to answer any questions you might have on the specifics of that system. I think that, in a summary or overview, is the proposal that's before you. I'm not sure, David, if you'd like other people to present or if we can just be available to answer questions.
Thanks, John. I should give a wonderful overview of what you did.
There were, let me say, four, I guess, specific issues that we were asked to address either at the site walk or at our last meeting. One was the status of our review before the Department of Human Services. We've received a letter from Mr. Bro. A copy, at least the letter we received, indicated a copy was sent to Mr. McVeigh, indicating that the review process is ongoing and that his agency has not issued a final decision.
What was the date of that letter, Dave?
Kenny Porter has it here with him.
I don't believe that the planning board has a copy of the letter, but it is in the town, and also I did talk with David Bro directly, and he did let me know that a final determination had not yet been made.
The letter was dated January 10th. The second question was raised by Mr. Boxer, and that had to do with the question of whether the proposed construction of the six-unit hotel cottage would require subdivision approval under the recent, I believe it's September 1988, amendments to the municipal subdivision law. I've reviewed that closely. It's my opinion that this would not qualify as a subdivision under that law. I have set forth my interpretation and reasoning in a letter to Ernie McVeigh, and have asked Mr. McVeigh to confirm on behalf of the town that the town's interpretation would also indicate that this is not would not require subdivision or review. I'm waiting to hear back from Mr. McVeigh on that, and I guess we'll deal with that issue when the town makes a final decision as to whether or not this is a subdivision.
Before we go on, can we get a comment on that, Steve?
Sure. Actually, the person who was reviewing it was Tom Leahy, the town's attorney. And I talked with Tom late last week and then this afternoon. And Tom at first thought that would have to go through subdivision review. Talking with him today, he felt that he wanted to spend a little more time looking at that more carefully. He wasn't sure at this point whether or not which way he thought the town should go. It's a relatively new change to the subdivision law. But what we decided was, in the meantime, that the planning board could and treat this application as if it were a site plan and not having to go through subdivision review. And a letter from Tom will be sent to the board within the next week or so, so we can get a determination one way or another. And so we and the applicants know.
A third issue that we were asked was to consider the town's Greenbelt program and to respond to a request for input as to how this particular applicant might contribute to the town's Greenbelt program. We recognize the town's policy as set forth in the subdivision ordinance, which is to have the planning board ask each developer to consider whether and how the developer might contribute to the town's Greenbelt program. While we think the Greenbelt policy is a good one for the town, and we acknowledge that it makes sense to have the planning board request this consideration at the time that an application for a development is received, because certainly if the request is not made at this time, it'll be too late to raise that issue after the development is completed. However, because the request is made at the time of the planning board's review of the subdivision or site plan application, we feel there's a risk that the request for a contribution to the town's Greenbelt program may be viewed as a component of the review process rather than a separate issue that happens to be raised at the same time. So before addressing specifically the Greenbelt issue, I'd like to explain to the board and to the public the context in which we've considered this request, and to ensure that our discussions of the Greenbelt issue are regarded as separate and unrelated from the board's deliberations on whether or not this application satisfies the applicable criteria under the site plan review ordinance. I've heard the view expressed that an approval for a development is a benefit bestowed upon the landowner by the town, and that the town is entitled to some benefit in return. I think this view overlooks the basic principle that a landowner has the right to build on his own property, and that the zoning ordinance, rather than bestowing that right, limits, restricts, regulates, and in some instances takes away that right. So that when we go through a review process asking the town or a body of the town to determine whether or not we meet the applicable criteria of the ordinance, we're not asking for a benefit to be bestowed upon the landowner. We're asking for the town to determine that the landowner can do what he has a right to do, consistent with the town's interest in promoting the health, safety, and welfare of the public. We see the planning board's role as a regulatory function, not to negotiate with the developer for the best deal it can get on behalf of the town, but instead to act in a quasi-judicial capacity and to determine whether the applicant has satisfied the specific criteria set forth in the ordinance. Viewed in the context, in this context, we think that the Greenbelt issue should not in any way factor into the review process, and we hope that our response to that is viewed in this way. We've tried to look closely at what this site and what the owner of this site might contribute to the town in terms of a contribution to or promotion of the town's Greenbelt policy. Some of the factors that we've had to consider are that we're not proposing to develop a previously undeveloped parcel of land. The inn property has been operating as an inn for a considerable period of time, and the Clark parcel, which has now been added to the inn site and which we're proposing to incorporate into the inn, has been a private residential lot. The public has not previously enjoyed a right of access to the state property across either parcel. The business of the inn is to provide accommodations and the use of its grounds and facilities to paying guests. Privacy, exclusivity, and security are part of what the inn sells. The public already has access to the marsh by way of the town cemetery and a strip of land leading to the town cemetery from Bowery Beach Road. On the site plan, the cemetery is here, immediately adjacent to the southwesterly corner, or southeasterly corner of the inn. The town owns a 10-foot strip leading from Bowery Beach Road to the cemetery. While it's not up to us to say that any member of the public has the right to go onto the state of Maine property, certainly anyone who had permission from the state to do so has ready access to that property along that 10-foot strip and through the cemetery. In fact, if you recall from the site walk that we took, the area directly below the cemetery is probably the area where the marsh can be most easily accessed. The site, the slope below the inn property itself has some fairly dense growth of bushes that would make it difficult to pass through in order to get down into the marsh area. The public already has access to the beach by way of the entrance to the state park and by the town landing at Kettle Cove. We feel that to provide additional access, additional public access to the beach across the inn property would detract to too great a degree from the sense of exclusivity that the patrons of the inn now enjoy, and it would be detrimental to the business of the inn. For the above reasons, we don't consider access to the marsh or access to the beach as something which this applicant can reasonably offer to the town. We think there is a much more meaningful way in which the applicant can, however, contribute to the town's Greenbelt program, and especially its concern for the quality of the marsh. The marsh is an important aspect to the inn as well as to the town. What we would like to offer is that the owners of the inn, either in cooperation with the Conservation Commission or on their own, will undertake an ongoing program to monitor water quality in the marsh, with an eye toward ensuring against any future degradation of the quality of the water in the marsh, and, if possible, to pinpoint the sources of any contamination now existing in the marsh, and to indicate what type of remedial steps might be taken. I think we ought to meet with the Conservation Commission, who we've learned have done some monitoring in the marsh in the past, and to coordinate with them the details of this program. But we feel that by offering this type of benefit to the town, that of through our hiring of consultants and provision of expertise in monitoring the quality of the marsh, we can ensure to the town a benefit far greater than that of additional access either to the marsh or to the beach. And we can ensure that those who do have access to those areas are going to enjoy at least the quality that exists there today. A fourth issue that we were asked to address is a determination of whether or not the existing on-site septic disposal facility or the proposed disposal facility might in any way contribute to the contamination of the marsh. You have a detailed report from John Seavey. I'd like to introduce Mr. Seavey now to describe briefly what his methodology was, what his conclusions were, and then I guess we'll all be open to respond to questions that the board might have.
Mr. Chairman, as you know, my name is John Seavey. I'm with Seavey and Mahar Engineers. We've provided environmental consulting services relative to the potential impacts of the wastewater disposal systems on this site. I'm just going to summarize very briefly our findings, and I'd be happy to answer any technical questions at the end.
Mr. Seavey, just one point.
Yes.
We do try to keep presentations to around 15 minutes and as a max.
Yes.
We are running a little bit over that at this point.
Okay. I'll try to keep mine to 5.
Thank you.
First of all, we examined nitrate levels. There were two basic elements of concerns relative to the wastewater disposal systems. One was nitrates and the other was microbes, bacteria and viruses. In examining the water in the marsh, we found the presence of nitrates, and we concluded that the existing system as well as the surrounding environs contribute nitrate to the marsh. The present level is somewhere around 4.5 milligrams per liter on an average, which is approximately 50% of the drinking water standard. Secondly, we examined the presence of bacteria in the marsh. We concluded from our studies that there is no indication that the microbes from the existing system or the proposed system is entering the marsh. We concluded this based on two pieces of information. One is we installed wells that I know the members here observed during our site walk. Those wells, after a sampling round, indicated no presence of microbes. There was a concern expressed relative to whether one sampling round would be adequate for this type of analysis. Our conclusion is, from a professional standpoint, that we are comfortable with one round of analysis for the principal reason that the existing system contributes effluent in a steady, constant manner. And because the system isn't operating for a while and then stopping and then operating for a while, but instead is providing effluent to the groundwater system all day long, that any evidence of that in a down gradient direction should also be present in a consistent and continuous fashion. Our sampling at two points in this down gradient area indicated no presence of microbes. The second thing that supports this finding is an analysis using the coarser grained soils, an analysis of the movement of the microbes through the coarser grained soils through the site. We sampled the coarser grained soils and we ran a permeability test on that and determined that the rate of movement would only carry the microbes about 120 feet. It's somewhere between 360 feet to where we sampled and possibly about another 50 feet to open water. So based on these two pieces of evidence, we feel that there is not a microbial contribution from this existing system to the marsh. We also concluded that a similar condition will exist for the future system. The microbes that are present in the marsh, we believe, based on our review of the CONCOM's data, the state's data, and our data, is a result of runoff from the surrounding lands and principally from animal life within the marsh itself. The proposed system will add an additional load of nitrates to the surface waters, but even with that additional loading, the levels will still be below the drinking water standards. Now, even though they're drinking waters, nobody's drinking this water, this provides one means of evaluating relative whether there's going to be a relative adverse effect or non-adverse effect. Finally, the nitrates that are being discharged from these systems as well as from the local surrounding areas is not a limiting factor in terms of the eutrophication that has issues that have been raised relative to the marsh by the Conservation Commission. The limiting factor is phosphorus. Phosphorus will not leach much more than a few feet below the bottom of this particular system, the proposed system or the existing system. So the nitrates, even though they may be added to the marsh, are not going to be the straw that breaks the camel's back. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Dave.
That concludes our presentation.
Thank you. I want to remind the group here, the board, that what we're here to review is a site plan review submission checklist for completeness. That's our primary issue tonight. However, there were some issues raised at the site walk that you have summarized. There was one issue that you chose not to address that I think that you should. We have correspondence in our packet from the Spray Corporation concerning their thoughts on the abutting property and rights of trespass. And did you get a copy of this letter?
We did. When the in-facility was being constructed, permission was granted by the Spray Corporation to go on to the adjacent property. Construction is now complete. We did receive a complaint, apparently from Chief Pickering, saying that the Spray Corporation was not at all happy with the way in which the use was made of the adjacent site. That letter was sent to the inn, I believe, in the fall of 1987. There has been no trespass, no use of the adjacent property whatsoever since that letter was received from Chief Pickering. Additionally, the proposal for the amendment to the site plan is for construction activity to take place on what we call the Clark Lot, which is located quite some distance from the Sprague property, and our development will not in any way occasion the need to use the Sprague property. So I think that issue, although it's unfortunate that that those problems did arise, has been laid to rest at this point, and I don't foresee any recurrence of what they were complaining about.
Mr. Chairman, yes. Just as a point of curiosity, I'm very interested in zoning ordinances and buffer zones, and the letter from the Sprags indicated that the tennis court was 2.5 feet from the property line. And if this is correct, do you have a variance or a conditional use permit from the zoning board? Was that granted to you?
I guess I'd like to ask Steve Moore to address that. It's my understanding that that it did not require a variance and did not require that it meet the setbacks set forth in the zoning ordinance. But to be sure, I'll ask Steve.
For what reasons? You know, it's just a point of curiosity, because we're going to be dealing with setbacks on the Clark property, and I think that we should get that.
Let me be sure I've got the correct answer before I give it to you. The answer is that the tennis courts were not considered to be a structure within the meaning of the setback requirements of the zoning ordinance, and therefore it was permitted to be built without compliance with the setback requirements that are applicable to structures.
And who determined that? Do we have a record?
I think the interpretation of the zoning ordinance in the first instance is the code enforcement officer's call. The plan was submitted to the code enforcement officer, to the Zoning Board of Appeals, and to the Planning Board. All three town officers or agencies reviewed the plan, and I don't know whether the minutes specifically reflect a decision on that issue, but I think it can be assumed, given the review process that it went through, that there was a determination that did not violate the setback requirements.
Well, according to Section 19-2-11 of the zoning ordinance regarding buffer areas, it states quite clearly that no building shall be erected, nor any new use permitted in business districts A, B, and C. I think your business district B.
That's right.
Not less than 25 feet in depth shall be left to remain in its natural state to ensure that such business districts shall be adequately screened, et cetera, et cetera. So you know, I mean, I know we've got this checklist.
Right. See, I think the key there is that this property line does not abut a residence district. The Sprague Corporation property is in the Business B district. And for that reason, the 25-foot setback did not apply to the Sprague Corporation property.
But it would apply.
It definitely applies to the
Clark property.
Well, the Clark property is now in Business B, but the Rautenberg property, which is
right,
here.
The Rautenberg property, right. Excuse
yes,
me.
Yes, that we, in fact, the setback requirement is 50 feet. There's a 25-foot buffer and a 50-foot setback for structures.
Right. Correct. But the according to my interpretation of the zoning ordinance, the planning board can require more for buffering at its discretion. If you want to check that out, it's on page 19-18 at the top. It says the buffer area may, at the discretion of the board, be in addition to the setback requirements. So that I'm assuming that that means that you'd have to meet the setback requirements plus a buffering. My interpretation of that.
I agree with that interpretation. If the board determines that it's necessary in order to comply with the requirements of the ordinance, then I think that's the case. We have not proposed the 50-foot setback to be in addition to the 25-foot buffering. The only place that that applies would be with regard to the six-unit building, which is here, and we've shown that as being set back 50 feet from the property line. Mm-hmm. The parking area does not require a 50-foot setback, but it does require that 25-foot buffer. And we have, in fact, discussed that buffer area quite extensively with the Rautenbergs, and I believe provision has been made to guarantee that they will be screened from any adverse effect of that parking lot.
Any other questions from the board? I guess I'd like to address a couple of the issues that you raised. They don't really speak to the completeness issue, but they do in one sense. The letter from Mr. Brow, I may be pronouncing the name wrong, Brow from the Department of Human Services, the original letter we have on December 16th seemed to indicate a denial. We're now saying that there's some correspondence in place here in the town hall which indicates that that was incorrect and that the process is ongoing. Is that your understanding?
That's right.
And that's our understanding also? Okay.
Yes.
So I guess what we would have to consider at this point, since this is an important aspect of the six-unit, the acceptance of that anyways, we would have to condition anything we do tonight based on that staying either ongoing or acceptance. Mm-hmm. Of course, if it turns to rejection, then we'd have to reconsider a number of items. So we'd have to do some conditioning on that front. The question of subdivision review, I guess we have not completed our attorney's answer on that one, so we would have to hold on what direction we take in terms of site plan or subdivision review, pending Tom's final word on that, which I guess is forthcoming?
Yes.
Okay. I'd like to speak a little bit to the Greenbelt issue. And I certainly am not the one to give you a legal interpretation of where the planning board stands on that. I can give you a planning board member's interpretation of it, and that's about all I can at this point. We really, while it's couched in terms, it seems like we're holding it over developers in the form of ransom, so to speak. It's not intended to be that at all. And I think your preceding comment attempted to make that clear. And I'd like to just clarify it a little bit further. The planning board has very little opportunity to try to implement the comprehensive plan, which includes the Greenbelt. any other way than when developers come before the planning board to present plans. It's not something that the town can do by eminent domain or by any other technique. So basically, it's a long-term, maybe 50 or 75-year process, which the town has undertaken to develop a greenbelt. And it's kind of an activity that happens when it happens. When a developer comes before us, it gives us an opportunity to see, does it make sense to make the request? And if it does, we make the request. It's not in any way intended to inhibit or limit the approval of a set of plans. That's not the either the spirit or the way that the request is made. The request is simply made at the time when it becomes possible to make the request. So I would like to reinforce the concept from my perspective anyways, that your acceptance of our request or denial will not in any way limit our acceptance or denial of this plan. We'll be looking at completeness. We'll be looking at a number of the issues that the planning board looks at on the plan. It is a separate issue. It is a request we make of all developers. So I hope that does clarify it. Do any of the other planning board members have any comments to make?
Mr. Chairman, I'm glad you brought up the question of the greenbelt. I don't think anybody who comes before this board ought to underestimate the value of the greenbelt plan to this community. I've said it before, and I've said it on sidewalks, and there are people who will be coming before us in the next agenda item or two who know how I feel personally about that. I'd like to ask, so that we were able to put a discussion about the greenbelt and potential connection of it to or through this property, should that happen, like to be able to put this section of the potential greenbelt in the proper perspective and ask Steve if you could come to the next meeting prepared to show the relationship between the easement which presently exists from Scott Dyer Road to the cemetery.
Scott Dyer from Bowery Beach.
Bowery Beach to the cemetery and the relationship of that to our greenbelt plan. I think we haven't asked you to extend your property boundaries beyond where they exist into our overall plan, but I think that would be helpful to put that in the proper perspective because it's an issue which I hope we'll continue to be able to discuss.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chairman, I don't necessarily agree with the applicant's words that were used regarding the board's review of projects and the requirements for green belts. I think that the language, at least in the subdivision ordinance, is clear. It's very concise, and there are requirements in the planning board that we have to determine the acceptability of the plans, not something that this planning board is arbitrarily holding over the head of any applicant that comes before the board. Now, whether or not that applies to site plan reviews perhaps is debatable. Whether or not this is a subdivision is debatable, and those will be presumably resolved by the time of the next meeting. But I also want to say, in saying that I don't agree with the presentation, that and I think it's appropriate, Mr. Russ's questioning of our planner, that we review the applicability of the greenbelt, we show how it fits in. I would also maybe further that by asking that we look at other public accesses that are immediately adjacent, as presented by the applicant tonight, including the state park, and just look at the total relationship rather than an individual site-specific relationship, and I think that's important. Perhaps even further, that this is an amendment to a previously approved site plan, and I remember the discussions that we had on the green belt at the previous application submission and approval process, and we had an extensive discussion about the green belt applicability at that time. And I think we should perhaps even review what was said at that time and bring it into the context for an amended site plan, and would ask that the minutes of that, the appropriate section of the minutes of that meeting be included in our next agenda so that we can see that. It's not a new discussion that's popping up today for an amendment. It's a discussion that we've had a considerable amount of time and effort expended on, and I think we should keep in the context of what has happened previously as well.
Thank you. Any other comments on this issue or other related issues? I have one other question that I think I raised at the time of the sidewalk, and I'm not sure that we really got an adequate answer to it tonight. If I'm not mistaken, the two wells that have been monitoring have been monitored for the degradation of the marsh in terms of picking up microbial content of the marsh. Were the two that we saw closest to the Sprague property, I believe. And it was indicated that those were tested in June. Is that, am I accurate in my recollection of that?
That's correct, Mr. Chairman. I guess I'd
like to hear a little bit more about your thoughts along the lines of how much the inn was operated up until that point, whether operation through the summer would have affected that reading, and why it would not be a good idea to get a reading at this point in time. I'm still unclear on why that would not be, from a strictly scientific point of view, more complete in the form of data.
Relative to the migration of the compounds from the wastewater disposal system, basically the effluent leaves the bottom of the system. There's a separation of 12 to 14 feet to the groundwater. It migrates vertically downward and then meets the groundwater table and then begins to migrate laterally toward the discharge point along the marsh. The rate at which that occurs, based on what we've estimated, is somewhere in the vicinity of 60 feet per day, I believe it is. Okay. So after approximately, if it's 360 feet, after approximately 360 divided by 60, which is 6, after approximately 6 days or so, the effluent has reached the, no, excuse me, after about 60 days, I'm off by a decimal, mm-hmm. after, it's 6 feet per day. After about 60 days, the effluent has reached the marsh, okay? The inn has operated, the septic system has operated, was operating for at least 2 months prior to the time of our sampling. I think it was around June 8th, okay?
So in what you just told us, it was reading basically April effluent, so to speak.
That's correct. And as a matter of fact, one of the things that supports that there may have been effluent in the vicinity is that the nitrate levels in those wells were elevated above background. Now, It's from a scientific standpoint, it's very difficult to say that it was definitely the wastewater disposal system, and that it wasn't fertilizers either from adjacent fields or from the inn's operations. But the levels of nitrates were elevated above what would be considered background for this area. So you could almost conclude in a sense that some of the effluent was reaching there, and the nitrates may in fact be operating as sort of a tracer, if you will, to indicate the presence of the effluent. The microbes themselves, as I mentioned before, they run out of fuel. Their food is lost. It's basically filtered out or used up as they transport through the groundwater system. And after a period of approximately 20 days, if you take a conservative estimate, the bacteria are basically have died out. If you consult the scientific literature, there's a couple of really good papers on this. The true longevity is somewhere in the neighborhood of possibly 7 to 14 days. So I like to think of the 20 days as somewhat of a conservative estimate, but it's something that's where you want to be when you're estimating these things. In terms of additional sampling, I think the only thing that I would request, Mr. Chairman, is that right now everything is frozen out there, and to encumber this particular application until things have thawed out may not be appropriate. If you consult the scientific literature, and I could provide the board with references, as many as they wish, if you consult the scientific literature, there's plenty of evidence to show that once you start a plume, it continues on through the groundwater system as long as the source is continuous. Therefore, our methodology, I think, was appropriate from a professional standpoint. As part of our discussions with the Conservation Commission, We have thought of possibly resampling those wells, and that could be done as part of that effort. I think one of the other issues that was brought up by the Conservation Commission was a tracer test, and with particular emphasis on whether the effluent makes it into the stormwater drain system. We don't believe that occurs because the stormwater drain system sits about 6 feet above the water table, and there's no way for the effluent to get into that, but we would also be discussing that. So I'd rather see that done as part of that program and not encumbered by this particular application.
Yeah, because if I'm not, time is leaving me at this point in time, but I don't think there was heavy use. The heavy use of the inn occurred this past summer. Is that as far as inn's first, was this past summer inn's first summer of operation or second?
Second.
So if you took a sample, for example, in October, you could conceivably be sampling August effluent.
That's correct.
And, of course, it's too late to do that, but my point being that it would seem to me that a second sample would have been, at a six-month interval, would have given some interesting information.
Do you understand why?
Yeah.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments on this package? Any questions on the completeness of the package? Mr. Butler, do you have any comments? Everything seems to be okay here.
Everything seems to be in order in terms of completeness.
Okay, it's, refresh me, is this, would we call for a hearing at our next meeting for a site plan? I believe so.
Yeah.
I think that's the issue we have to set at this point in time, is whether we want a hearing at our next, accept the package you submitted and set the date for a hearing or not set the date for a hearing.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion.
Okay.
Be it ordered on the assumption that the applicant does not need to undertake subdivision review, that the planning board deems the site plan review application to be complete for the expansion of the Inn by the Sea with the addition of a 6-unit detached cottage and the opening of the existing 48-seat restaurant to the public, and as proposed by the Great Cumberland Realty Trust. Be it further ordered that the planning board will hold a public hearing regarding this proposed expansion at its March 1st meeting, unless it is determined by the town attorney that this application should be reviewed under the town subdivision ordinance.
We hear a second?
Second.
Any further discussion on this motion as presented?
Mr. Chairman, only that there has been significant comment and correspondence regarding the proposed expansion and the amendment to the site plan, and I really feel we should be having a public hearing on this site plan to give those neighbors, abutters, and interested parties an opportunity to express their feelings.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, are we going to have the benefit of the correspondence from inland?
Fisheries and Game, Bob Hunter, this response to the drainage plan, Conservation Commission's comments regarding additional testing. Will you have that information before the public hearing?
Yes,
it's scheduled for March 1st.
We will be submitting the information from IF&W, from Mr. Hunter, the town engineer, and from Conservation prior to that. With regard to, Joe, I think you said additional testing as well. Is that
I guess there was some question as to whether the Conservation Commission and you might agree that additional testing would be worthwhile in the from the existing wells.
We don't feel it's necessary at this time to do additional monitoring in the wells.
Okay.
The reason for that, as John mentioned, is that once that plume is generated, that plume is a continuous thing, and you're going to be sampling the same plume in June that you sample in October. John's very confident in that. Dr. Rand did raise one issue in his letter that we think we can put to rest fairly simply. He said that our conclusions would be invalidated if there were infiltration of the effluent into the stormwater system. And that can be tested fairly readily by doing a dye test and monitoring the stormwater outflow to see whether there's any dye getting into the stormwater system. And we will plan to do that test before the next meeting.
Okay.
Thanks. Okay, also the other issue that I guess we will need to have some resolution of, or at least some direction on, is the Board of Health issue with the state. You feel that based on conversations you've had with the state that they'll be reaching some decision prior to our March 1st date? Can you guess at that, or is that just conjecture?
At this point, I don't know how long they'll take. I can tell you that in our meeting with Mr. Breaux, he indicated to me that he had not reviewed the application in light of the relevant criteria under the minimum lot size law, that he was looking at it from a purely subjective view, and I encouraged him to consult with the assistant attorney general assigned to his department for an interpretation of the law before he issued an opinion, and he said that he would do that. How long he's going to take, I don't know, but certainly this board can and should make any decision that it reaches conditioned upon receipt of that approval. And if under the minimum lot size waiver that we seek, we cannot proceed with the development that we're proposing, then obviously we'll be back to the town, not simply to the planning board, but basically back to square one with the zoning board. So I don't see that this board necessarily has to postpone its decision of this pending the outcome of the minimum lot size waiver. I think it's implicit, it can be made explicit, that the approval is contingent upon our receipt of that permit. And if we can't get it, that means we can't build what we're proposing to build, which means we go back to the zoning board.
So it's going to have to be a contingent acceptance if we accept on that basis.
That's right.
Okay.
May I mention one other thing?
Sure.
The Clark lot was rezoned to a business B in February of 1988. The zoning ordinance says that, and that rezoning became effective in March of 1988. The zoning ordinance says that unless we commence construction of our proposed development within 1 year after the zoning amendment becomes effective, the planning board shall undertake steps to rezone the property to its original zoning. So I think in March of 89, I guess we need to have some indication from the planning board that this is an ongoing process, and that obviously we feel that we've made every good faith effort to be as diligent as possible in pursuing this. And that I recognize that the zoning amendment doesn't expire or revert automatically, but I guess I'd just like to bring that up and have it on the table and make it clear that as long as we're proceeding as quickly as we feel is reasonably possible, that the planning board will cooperate with us and not kick into a mode where the town seeks to rezone this back to a residential A.
Well, I don't think we can address that issue since we have a motion.
I'm just putting it on the table now.
Mr. Chairman, this board has never been accused of moving with lightning speed.
It probably never will.
Never will.
Are there any other discussions?
Mr. Chairman, just one last thing. On the zoning of the Sprague property, did I not hear you state that it was zoned business? Because I was under the impression from a case last spring that the entire Sprague property is residential zone. So it's just something that I think we should have our town attorney check.
Mr. Chairman, that's a question that's come up before, and it turns out that portion of the Sprague Corporation Fields are zoned as a business
they
district.
They are. Thank you.
Interestingly enough.
Any further discussion on the issue of completeness in the motion that was made? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Your motion is complete. The application is complete. February 10th would be your deadline for submission of additional data.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Right on. Our next item, we're a little bit behind schedule, is Jordan Zagway Lawn and Garden Site Plan Review. It's supposed to be on at 8:45. We'd like to take that issue next. We have a representative of Mr. Jordan present.
Yes, good evening. My name's David Leisure from John Leisure Architects, and here representing Jordan's Lawn and Garden Center for a 1,500-square-foot addition to his existing retail facility, which will be primarily used for storage, and a crushed stone parking lot for definition of vehicular drives and parking. We have before you here tonight what we believe is the final plan. According to the site walk and with discussions with Mr. Bob Hunter, the town engineer, and Stephen Butler, your planner, we have made some additions and changes to the site plan, and I would be happy to take the board through those minor changes at this point. They are as follows.
Just to orient yourselves, this is the plan that we received this evening, dated January 12, 1989. Is that right?
Yeah, that's correct.
It's not the one that was in your package.
It's not the one that we submitted 20 days prior. It was submitted approximately a week ago, I believe.
Good.
The minor changes are we first showed a fence along the easterly border. We have opted to delete that fence given the 12 pine trees, all global shaped, along that will provide adequate screening at this point. And when once pruned, will even grow wider and provide screening for the easterly part of that parking lot for cars and so forth in the parking lot. We have enlarged and relocated the yews that were on the southerly side of the parking lot and down near the 7-car parking spaces on the southernmost portion of the site. They were 24 inches in height, and we've enlarged those also to 30 inches in height to give immediate screening for cars and so forth. We have relocated them along the property line to provide that screening and to allow us to push snow into a snow dump area at the southerly portion of the crushed stone parking area. We have eliminated them here in front of the trellis area to also allow for a snow dump area. Bob Hunter has reviewed this and has made the suggestion to, even though the site slopes approximately 1% in pitch towards this ditched area along 77, he has suggested that we raise the parking lot in the rear approximately a foot, giving it a 2% pitch and pitching that for positive drainage towards that ditched area. We have also added all three elevations of the new 1,500 square foot shed building to the rear of the property. I believe that's all the changes we have made from that package. If there's any questions, I'd be happy to address those.
Does any board have questions?
Mr. Chairman, I don't have any questions. I think that the addition of the buffering is excellent. I think that we have a letter here, January 10th, from the town engineer, that the disposal system, the site distances, the drainage, everything seems to be in order. This is an old, well-respected business. The site plan looks good, and I'm all for moving forward with it.
I would have one question for our planner. We're looking at our site plan review submission checklist. We have two partials, a number of partials. Would you care to address the partials for us, just so we have a better understanding of why they're stated as partials at this point?
Sure. Going down through the list, first partial is number 7, which deals with the building setback, sideline, and rear yard distances. It's a minor point. They're listed. They're a little hard to see, but that's in essence is an okay in 7, unless you want to be very technical. On 8, there was some discussion with Mr. Jordan and Mr. Leisure about indicating the soils type, even generally, on the site, and that wasn't done, but again, relatively minor. Number 9 and 12A were two items that were pending, though in my mind at least, were pending Bob Hunter's review and Bob, Mr. Hunter feels that both of those are okay. So I would change 9 and 12A to okay, Which you really leave.
And his latest version has some part of it shown, right?
Yes. Yeah. Let's say the only one that was really outstanding was 8A, and that is relatively minor.
Any other comments?
Question, or comment, I guess. Assume that in Bob Hunter's review of the drainage, he looked at the capacity of the culvert that's located closest to the driveway. On the site visit, that was my only, in addition to the screening which you've provided for in your revised site plan, the only other concern I had was whether that culvert was large enough to carry the flow when the water sheeted across the parking lot. I just assume that Bob's review of the drainage plan approves that. But it might be something for you to keep your eye on as you develop.
I don't want to speak to that, Joel. It is a fact it's a crushed stone parking lot. For 6 to 7 months of the year, it will be permeating water through that surface. Mm-hmm. And for the other period of the time, it will be frozen in the form of snow or ice, and it will be released from the site approximately the same pre as post. And so we don't feel it's very much impact at all.
Mr. Chairman, if there are any other issues regarding completeness, there may be two or three items that I like to go through to make sure that the board's understanding is up to the level where I think it should be in terms of what's being proposed. There are a lot of things have changed since the plan that you saw versus tonight. The size of the buffer plantings at the time they are actually planted, that wasn't indicated, and that's...
It's 30...
You
shown
had any...
Here.
Yes.
Shown here is 30-inch height for you.
Okay.
That's the screening along 77, right?
Yes, right. Shrub-like.
Okay, then in terms of the 12 white pines?
12 white pines are existing there and were overlooked initially. They are existing along that property line and act very well as an adequate buffer. They are there.
Okay. I guess I would ask whether if the issue of screening the parking lot from the adjacent properties is an issue, then I'm not sure that the existing pines would prevent car lights from being buffered as they're shining onto the two properties right along the property there.
In our opinion, they're all very healthy trees and all round, very rounded and low to the ground and provide fairly good screening. And if he cuts those, tops them all, and starts to form those in the shape of a hedge, they'll get even better, and that's what we propose to do, rather than the fence, which we felt was more unsightly.
So, I mean, depending upon what the board thinks about in terms of screening of headlights, again, I'm not sure it does the job, but it might be sufficient. Okay, the other issue in terms of planting is that if they're existing or to be planted, that assumes that if they for some reason die or become unhealthy, that they'll be replaced as necessary.
You've got the right guy in the right business to take care of plants, so I don't see that as a problem.
That's right. Okay. There's some issue in terms of some of the temporary signs and displays that sometimes are present on the Jordan Lawn and Garden Center site, and at a town staff meeting, it was suggested that with the approval of this new addition, that perhaps those temporary signs and displays could be limited in the future. That I think would be beneficial to the town.
I'd have to. This is the first I've heard of it. I'd have to turn that over to Gil for exactly what you're talking about.
I don't know exactly. About 3 years ago in the past, we did have a temporary sign that was on wheels that we used to wheel out at the time. But we have since removed that because at times we noticed that it could cause a traffic hazard. for viewing the traffic in one direction. But we have done away with that sign altogether. And the only sign that we have or will have is the one that is on the property now, which, when the new one comes, will be even smaller than the one that's there.
Okay. So in terms of if a condition on the approval was to limit the future use of those temporary signs,
yes,
then that would be acceptable to you?
Oh, yes, yes.
And Mr. Jordan, to the point of headlights in the parking lot, could you comment on your hours of operation and how often will you be open at night when it's dark?
We close at 5 o'clock in the wintertime at the dark. Our busiest season is, we call it Memorial. So we're going to have our parking lot and usage of parking lot would be approximately 2 weeks before Memorial and 2 weeks after Memorial. But during the winter months, we close at 5 o'clock. The traffic going in and out of that parking lot would be very, very limited. I make one small comment. It might be some person that is standing very close to you that might cause some lights to go in there. Sorry.
Okay, thank you. Just a point of information.
Okay. I guess one last question I'd ask Mr. Jordan. In terms of the parking area, will you be maintaining it, but also keeping it plowed, the entire parking area year-round?
Yes, yes. We've plowed most of it anyway in the wintertime. There's probably about 15 feet of what we've got proposed that we did not plow in the past. But other than that, we always have pushed the snow back to allow us, in big storms and so forth, to keep it in plenty of room.
Okay, so then in the future, all the parking spaces shown here will be usable if
yes.
needed.
Yeah.
Thank you. Any other questions on the issue of completeness of this application? Do we have a motion in respect to this?
Chairman, yes. I'd like to make a motion that if the order that the request of Gilbert Jordan for site plan approval for construction for Gilbert Addition and a parking lot at the Jordan's Lawn and Garden Center located off Ocean House Road be granted according to Section 19-2-9 of the Zoning Ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. A, that all construction and improvements that are related to this site plan approval must be completed within 6 months from the approval date. B, that all parking areas shown on the site plan shall be maintained and kept usable on a year-round basis. C, that all new plantings shall be of a sufficient size to provide adequate buffering as determined by the town planner and the code enforcement officer prior to the issuance of a building permit. D, that all indicated plantings and vegetation must be maintained in a healthy state and replaced when necessary. E, that no temporary signs, and I am suggesting the removal of the phrase or displays. No temporary signs shall be allowed on the site except those allowed by the town's current ordinances and regulations. F, that the two new, in quotes, area lighters, unquote, will be wired to a time clock and will be illuminated from 4 p.m. to 11 p.m. or for a lesser period of time within said limits. And G, and finally, that the above-mentioned condition shall be placed on the site plan.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion on this?
Mr. Chairman, under A, that all construction and improvements have to be completed within 6 months, is there any reason for that? Why does it happen? Why do these improvements have to be completed within 6 months?
It was based partially on what Mr. Jordan and Mr. Leisure have told the board and the staff, that things were going to happen right away. But I think what's going to happen first is that the addition will be put on, and it was the position of the town staff that the parking lot be constructed in a relatively close period to the point in which the addition was put on. That some of the town staff did not want to see the addition put on and then the parking lot not constructed for 9 months, 12 months, a year and a half. It was anticipated that all would be done. I think this is pretty much just a safeguard to make sure that would happen. 6 months was, you know, a figure that was mentioned that could be changed.
Mm. Well, I mean, I'm just thinking that the winter months are coming upon us, and does this present problems for you, Mr. Jordan, to have it all? This says that it has to be all completed in 6 months. I mean,
it could be close. Excuse me. The building construction and parking lot probably. Planting might, some of the planting of the trees could hold us back a little bit. I'll be truthful. To get the building done and the parking lot, I don't think there's any problem there. But to get some of the plantings in at that time, as I mentioned before, we will be very busy. We start our greenhouse work up within another week or two, and that's going to be taking some of our time. But as far as the plantings, I think it's the only problem that I could see.
Mm. Well, you know, when I do repairs at my house, I can wait 4 months for someone to come to just do the repairs. You're going to have to build this from scratch. And I'm just concerned that this whole, after what you have been through, that all of this could be rescinded if you don't meet this six-month approval date. And I don't know if I'm in favor of that. I would like to see it worded. If the town is concerned about the parking lot along with the building, then couldn't we reword A so that we don't...
Mr. Chairman, I'd be happy to change the motion to insert a longer period of time.
I think that's probably advisable at this point.
I mean, 9 months would seem to me more than adequate to do.
Okay, we have a
yeah, sounds louder.
We have a motion on the table. I believe we should at this point in time vote on an amendment. Make a motion on an amendment to that and pass on the amendment before we vote on the final motion. So is there a motion for an amendment at this point?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we amend Section A and instead of 6 months, replace that language with 9 months from the approval date.
Is that acceptable to the original motioner? Okay. Is there a second to the amendment? All those in favor of the amendment?
Aye.
Opposed? Amendment passes, is now worded as a 9 month period. Is there any further discussion on the amended motion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Your permit is granted for site plan approval.
Thank you very much.
We're pretty much on time now. 9:15, Hidden Court. Do we have representatives of Hidden Court present? Please identify yourself.
Yes, good evening. My name is Sarah Marshall. I'm with Terrence DeWan and Associates Landscape Architects, and I'm here tonight to represent Robert and Kimberly Davis of Cumberland Foreside, who are the subdividers of this land right behind us, known as Hidden Court. You've all been there now, so you're familiar with the project. I'd like to just go over the goals and the philosophy, just very briefly, of what we're trying to do, and then make sure that everything that we've submitted since we were last here is in order and that our application is complete and to your satisfaction. The property, as you know, is a very special, unique property, and it was owned and maintained lovingly by the Robinson family for many years. And it is the goal of this of this subdivision application to meet with their approval and to meet all of their conditions and deed restrictions submitted to you most recently was the deed restrictions. It was in our last packet submitted the 30th of December. Those conditions state, one, that no more than two new residences shall be erected on the land, and we show those building envelopes here and here, that they'll be maintained as single-family residences, that the grantees, and the new lot owners, and the Robinson Shoal have right to Zeb's Cove. And so our plans have respected those wishes from the start. In addition, we've done some research on the feasibility of the water. It was mentioned at our last meeting that would we have wells, would we have town water. We've looked into both, and they're both feasible, and it's a matter of doing a little further work and discovering which is the most economical. We have a water district letter from Donald Wyman stating that service could easily be provided to any of these lots. In response to the planning board concerns of the driveway access, I think that we arrived at a good solution when we were out at the site most recently. Can you see the around the corner from me? Hold it up a little higher. The existing driveway to the stone house here presents no problems. This house already also has its own driveway. The proposed driveway to this lot number two is doesn't seem to be a traffic or safety problem. There's good site distances, and we can locate the drive opposite the Realty building right here on the street. The sticky wicket has been this lot, and in order to try to keep the feeling of the estate and to minimize the curb cuts along the road here, to maintain that wooded edge, we propose that the users, the builders on this lot, use the existing driveway for exit only, which means they would come in this drive as it exists, make this turn, and come into their building lot here, and that they would use this driveway here for exit only. And I'm sure that you might have concerns about, well, how can we enforce this? It's a matter of honor and a matter of safety. I think anybody would want to do what was right and safe, and we all have a responsibility to obey the one-way signs that we see every day. So that's our proposal for the driveway use, and we do show the alternate driveway here, which we saw out in the field. This is something that would be implemented if and when another owner, when the lot was transferred to another owner, the Davises would have the right to deny them use of this driveway and to require them to build this other approved as an alternate by you. That's in order to protect the convenience and privacy of the Davis residents. I think the other major issue was public access and the Greenbelt plan, and in response to that, as you know, we are restricted by the language of the deed restrictions and covenants and conditions. I think it is, it's always been the Robinson family's intent to preserve this estate as it is, and there's, and I think, an increasing sentiment that open space, even if seen from the water, even if just seen driving by, is a valuable commodity to any town. And we hope that the preservation of the Zeb's Cove area and the large open field, the 1,200-foot setback for any kind of building from the beach will meet the goals of the town in satisfying the open space plan. I'd like to quote from the minutes of the Conservation Commission meeting, which was held on January 5th. They, of course, as you've read, respond to many or several projects. Their priorities are several. They're interested in visual resources and wetland protection and water quality, pollution. None of those are issues on our project. The minutes state that because plans had been submitted to the Planning Board for development, the Commission discussed various approaches that have been considered for its preservation. It was pleased to learn of several deed restrictions that had been placed that would guarantee the open nature of the field between Zeb's Cove and the main residential buildings. I think this brief summary of the Conservation Commission's feelings reinforces what we've been attempting to do, is to guarantee to the town that this land would be as it is now in perpetuity. And if there are any other solutions to the problem, I guess we don't see them at this time because of the constraints that we have upon us. I think that our application is in order, and if there are any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. We also have several others with us tonight.
This completes your presentation, basically?
Yes.
Okay. Are there any questions from the board?
Mr. Chairman, do you know offhand what the width of the roads?
The existing roads out here?
Yes.
I would say 24 feet. They're not wide enough for two lanes. There's two. It's just a standard 24-foot paved area with an 8-foot shoulder or so. It's it's basically level, clear on
and
both
is
sides.
It, will it be written in the deeds that these roads must be plowed by the owners?
Are you talking about the roads on the estate?
All of the roads that are existing there now.
The driveways?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were talking about the public right-of-way.
I call them minor little roads.
That's probably more like 12-foot, isn't it? I believe this one is paved, and this one is a dirt or a gravel.
No, I think that they are in excellent condition now, but I think that it should be written into the deeds that that they should be clear, you know, and made to at least be 18 feet so that emergency vehicles could enter.
I think in the interest of the safety of the lot owners,
Of the people who live there.
18 feet is an excessive amount for a private way, but not if you just consider the actual traveled way plus the shoulders.
Right.
You want to be sure that a fire engine or a police car could get just around an obstruction.
Right, just to keep it cleared.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it should also be written into the deeds that these roads must be kept in good condition and plowed during the winter and made accessible.
I think that would be acceptable. That's a matter of survival.
Could I go on about the one-way street? If at a later date the property is going to be liquidated perhaps to another person, why don't you, I think when I was there I made a suggestion that you make just one curb cut in the interests of safety, and that curb cut would be on Old Ocean House Road and meet the existing summer driveway. And then the existing gate could be just an exit only. So why would you have people sharing roads without an association? You know, why wouldn't the curb cut be made right at the beginning and have it done properly so that we know that everything would be safe, there would be no sharing of lands, etc.? And that would be my other suggestion. And I think that this piece of property is without a doubt a jewel of rare value. And I think that the whole approach to it
is one of the most sensitive approaches I have ever seen. And in the words of President-elect George Bush, and everyone is using them, this is a kinder and gentler subdivision. And I am in total agreement with the letter from Dr. Ran, who states that for many reasons, the Conservation Commission is not in favor of attempting to impose a greenbelt dedication on this property at this juncture. And I'm a proponent of the greenbelt. However, I do agree with Dr. Rand, and I think it is excellent that he has said this, put this opinion in writing, because I feel that the town has inadvertently been given so much. When you think of what could have been built there, it is just astounding to see this. And the Greenbelt is certainly Dr. Rand's baby. And for him to make a comment like this, I am in total agreement with him. And that's all I have to say about this.
In response to your question about the driveway, why not just do the additional curb cut, keep it all on one property? That would be, I think, a workable solution for just a couple of reasons. The people who are going to be living there prefer this solution. And one is that they're trying to respect in every way possible the wishes of the Robinsons. And one of their wishes is that it be maintained as it is. And so for them to cut through those trees to regrade just even slightly that embankment just seems unnecessary. And we have to, of course, respect the needs of the town for the safety of everyone who's traveling this way. But that is the feeling of the family. It's also, I think, the wishes of the future owners of this lot that they have a kind of a historic entrance, and they'd like to share in the heritage of this estate, and for that reason they'd like to use one of the existing driveways. Mm-hmm. And so if this is an acceptable solution, that's one.
Town engineer and the police department would have to look at all of that.
Yeah. The site distances at this exit are more than adequate looking down Old Ocean House Road. You can see for a long way who's coming, and that's why we propose that it be used as an exit.
For my benefit, because I really missed it because the podium is slightly obscuring, could you trace that path, entrance and egress again for me?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now?
Yes, okay.
We propose that the users, owners of Lot 3, enter through the main drive, mm-hmm, and come to this turning point just before the house, and it's in good condition, and that they come to their house this way. And as you know, their house would most likely be at the top of this hill looking down that view line. So they would come to this point. And then for points of exit, they would come out the existing drive.
Do you think for practical purposes that will be done? Really?
I'm told. I think that they would be respectful of your wishes.
Mr. Chairman, if I can follow up, just a couple of quick questions. I notice on the plans you show an exit-only sign with an arrow that says entrance is down the road a little ways. I don't see any entrance sign being proposed. One issue.
Here.
I don't see it.
It says sign.
Oh, okay.
But we need to work out what that would be.
That's pretty small. secondly, I assume that the owners of Lot 1 need to provide that access easement.
Yes.
And I don't believe the board has a copy of that easement.
No, you don't. The language has been drafted. Am I correct? You were talking with Ron Ward about the what would be included in that. Yeah.
Third, we talked over the phone, Sarah, about getting some more information from your traffic engineer in terms of the use of that entrance, and I didn't recollect seeing any information provided.
Of this entrance?
No.
This one? No, he didn't, when he was out in the field looking at these various driveways, he didn't quantify, as we suspected, the site distances of this existing driveway. And I called him up after we spoke, and he said that it was, the distances were more than adequate looking down Old Ocean House Road, that they were in excess of 350 feet, I believe. And that he, I think, felt that they were not adequate turning, you know, looking around this way, and therefore that, and in addition to the island, that exit and turning left would not be advisable. He said he would recommend to the town the lengthening of this island if the driveway were to be used in any other fashion than only for turning right.
Okay, but the materials in the packet pretty much refer to the alternate driveway location for Lot 3 at the present time.
Yeah, I think what we have to keep in mind here is that this property has had limited use over the past few years. We're proposing now adding two residences. The property, as I believe the history, correct me if I'm wrong, when it was originally built, there really was no Route 77 going down to join up with Barrow Beach Road. That old Ocean House Road was Ocean House Road. So many changes have taken place over the years. We are now talking about more use of the property, certainly not great use of the property. Two houses is not a development, certainly. But there will be use of that entrance when there has been practically none over the past few years. We have an obligation to ensure the safety of the town. That's one of our primary prerequisites of planning board activity. And your answers lead me to believe that not only has that entrance been looked at, but there may be some problems with what was found. And we, if I'm not mistaken, correct me if I'm wrong, we don't have any of that data in our possessions at this point in time.
That there are problems?
Or the traffic analysis at all. Is that true?
You do have Bill Bray's letter of December 29th that was submitted in our December 30th.
But it refers just to the one alternate driveway location.
Right.
He says the center line of the driveway should be located. So he's telling us where he believes it should be, and that is at this point. I think that implicit in those words is his feeling that this driveway should be discontinued. And we are attempting another solution. If that's not acceptable, then we must, you know, seriously consider this.
I think we have to be very careful before we take your own expert's opinion and throw it out the window, that we have some real good sound safety reasons for doing that.
Mr. Chairman. Are you going to... Mr. Chairman, when we did the site walk, I think we all had a problem with the use of the summer gate for an in-and-out movement of traffic. I think the problem was more an in-movement of traffic than an out-movement, and it generally seemed like, as an exit, and respecting the nature of the road and the historical use of the property,